So, our next speaker is Associate Professor at Aalborg University, the department here in Copenhagen, Bolette Blaagaard, who is working on cultural studies and journalism and communication, and who has done research on coloniality and journalism, and is currently working on a book about the Danish West Indian newspaper, The Herald. So that's what we're going to hear about. So thank you.
Is it working? I'm not sniffling into the microphone. Sorry. I want to start by thanking the Danish West Indian Society and the Friends of Denmark for giving me some time to speak today, because I was supposed to go to St. Croix earlier this year and I couldn't make it, so I'm so happy that you allowed me to speak today. I will be talking about The Herald, and I'm going to be talking about journalism and how journalism may work to produce citizenship, but it's not the kind of citizenship that we've just heard about. It's a kind of cultural citizenship. In terms of political engagement, I'm just going to find some space here. Political engagement in a community, and how journalism, in particular the journalism that David Hamilton Jackson produced in The Herald, what kind of community and what kind of citizenship that produced. And I'm also going to talk about cosmopolitanism, so in terms of how The Herald brought together different communities of solidarity within its pages. So, something quite different from what we just heard, and still perhaps the same. So, I'm going to be talking about the role of journalism in these colonial St. Croix and beyond. And of course, the Herald was published and written largely by David Hamilton Jackson, and you probably know him very well, but I'm just going to go over it quite quickly, that he was the son of a school teacher and also taught in the local schools before he pursued a career as the founder and editor and writer of the Herald. And later on, he also had a career as a lawyer. He's very well known in the colonies, so everyone here from the colonies, the former colonies, would know him very well, obviously. In Denmark, he is unfortunately not that well known. It is very slowly changing, but it's not good. I feel like I'm Madonna. They're boring when Madonna does this. Sorry. So this talk is not about the man, it's not about David Hamilton Jackson so much as it is about what he wrote and what the impact of what he wrote in The Herald. And I'll start by showing you how I think that The Herald was a political act to produce a citizenship, a cult for citizenship, and how it generated a new public or new people in his own words. That is, I wanted to show the local role of The Herald. And I'm going to be presenting some examples from The Herald, and then I'll continue to show how this new public engaged through the paper was transposing citizenship beyond the geographic borders and bringing together historical events in renewed understanding of citizenship and citizen participation. So that is the more cosmopolitan perspective. So my talk is not about the entire newspaper. It was 10 years worth of newspaper. It's focused on 1915 to 1917, perhaps for all these reasons. So to focus on The Herald and the local people first, and the people he wrote to and for. The Herald formed a part of a process of political engagement aimed at improving the working conditions on the islands through education and information, deliberation, but also through the union, the labor union. Of course, he was a leader of the labor union as well. So in the very first edition of The Herald, he writes, let's see what he writes this. So with many apologies, we today send forth our first book printed sheet with the hope that its readers will find in it what it has long wanted, a paper for the people. A certain great writer once said, give the people what they want and there should be no discontent. We want our people to have all they're entitled to as citizens. So perhaps connecting to the talk early on, he definitely saw the population of the islands as citizens. Now, in the context of 1915 St. Croix, only two other newspapers were published at the same time. They were the St. Croixitis, which was an official government outlet under changing names since 1770, and which still exists today, I believe.
Yes.
And the West End News, which had existed on the island since 1912, and within which Jackson himself had previously written pieces and agitated for his political views. Now, these were the outlets which implicitly were not for the people when he's writing this, right? So you want a paper for the people. It's not enough what we have already. Ideologically, the Herald was attached to the social democratic movement, the labor movement, and displayed in its heading, as you can tell, or you could see it earlier on, liberty, equality, and fraternity. The obvious reference to this major citizens' uproar and to a democratic agenda points to Jackson's call for citizens' participation in social and political change and through personal and educational transformation. So this is his political aim through the paper. Moreover, social democratic Danish papers such as Socialdemokraten and Politiken were mentioned in the first edition of the Herald as supporters of the political cause and journalistic work. So clearly for Jackson, the Herald was a participatory means for a political end. He was a labor union man, and he wrote not because he particularly liked journalism necessarily, but he wrote to change his community for the better. So I want to give you another quote. It's quite long, but it's worth it, I think, from the first edition of the Herald. He says, it's not our intention to antagonize any existing paper or journal, but we certainly are in the field to defend the darker race from attacks by the papers, journals and journalists opposed to their progress and march towards their heritage. If we were to tell the truth in its fullness about the present conditions on the islands, then we should unhesitatingly lay the blame into the inactivity of the press. You can also read it yourself. So let us go back to the time when the common people in Denmark had no paper or organ of their own, and what do we find here? Oppression and semi-slavery. It is through the spread of newspaper literature in Denmark that Denmark has become the most free nation in the world. So this is interesting to me because in his address, Jackson simultaneously conjures up a counterpublic. He's against something. He's an underdog, the defender of the darker race, on whose side he stands. But simultaneously, he rehearses the slogan of deliberative democracy built on free press, which is a very sort of European Enlightenment idea. So explicitly presenting the colonial ruler as a role model, to some extent, to which the island should aspire, Jackson also claims a political desire in opposition to the colonial administration. So Jackson continues with a cry for civil inalienable rights to the downtrodden and hope and with a hope for the newspaper to be able to promote, I'm quoting him, to promote a better feeling between the new factions and hope finally to create a united Santa Cruz and a new people bonded in love and union. So this is his aim with this newspaper. This is important to him. So while Jackson's address may be seen as an expression of traditional universal liberal politics emphasizing freedom and equality within the rule of law, simultaneously, Jackson's political and journalistic work in the Herald may be characterized as ruptures from social historical patterns because it's insistence of a particular case, the particular case of the Frisian people. Now, this is because of this social and political display of community building by addressing the African Caribbean people in the colonies as political subjects and the public. So I want to just take a moment to talk about this idea of the counterpublic because I think it's important to what Jackson is doing in the paper. The idea of a public or a counterpublic is he understood in opposition to the public. which is seen as an expression of political dominating power, in this case the colonial ruler. Right? And we're still talking about this in cultural terms, so we're not talking about this in terms of law. You know, it's about how we perceive ourselves and how we are able to speak up and be heard. So this idea of a public includes the idea that publics are constituted through address, and this is when people are addressed, they become a public that is self-organizing as a relation among strangers. So I'm addressing you, and so we are a public. So a public is not necessarily identical or even identifiable with the public sphere addressed through dialogical deliberation. So we are not necessarily the same thing as the Danish public sphere where politicians are speaking or the mainstream media or whatever. We are a public in our own right. Indeed, a counter-public is often defined as in conflict with the public sphere. So a theorist called Nancy Fraser is saying in this way that they are parallel discursive arenas where members of subordinated social groups invent and circulate counter-discourses, which in turn permits them to formulate oppositional interpretations of their identities, interests, and needs. And this is very much what the Herald was doing. It's not the Herald that's doing, it's Jackson who's doing it through the Herald. So publishing the Herald, in which Jackson addressed the particular social, political, and educational needs of the African Caribbean population through articles on healthcare, childminding, as well as daily vocabulary and reading lists for the education of the people, may be seen as a discursive counterpublic. So my argument here is that he creates a people through his, he's addressing a certain people that have been excluded early on. So, through his political and educational writings in the Herald, Jackson addressed the African Caribbean people as a particular community, a people, not as exclusive or excluding, but in agonistic or opposing, but interrelated relation to the colonial power. So, although Jackson had legally obtained the rights to publish his newspaper by the Danish government, and he often wrote admiringly about the Danish freedoms and press, and you saw an example of that earlier on, he also quite clearly addressed the racial and social problems of the colonial society. Those are the addresses that I believe are the sort of citizen media. They are the addresses that rupture this social historical pattern. It's the particularities of this society and what journalism is able to do. So for example, the second issue, or actually the first real issue of the newspaper on November 1st, says here, and he writes this, the circular sent out by the agricultural experiment station should not be taken as applying to the small squatters. So what he's referring to here is that the squatters who made up the African Caribbean population should not sign anything that they did not understand. This is the warning in the newspaper. Right? So the circular was meant for the planters. It says it's mainly white plantation owners on the islands. And similarly, a case of possible wrongful detainment of a man's firearms by the gendarmerie makes him write this in mid-November in 15. He says, in fact, the people ought to know something about the gendarmes and their connections with the civil authorities. So he's quite explicit about being against the colonial. He knows that there are issues here, and he's sort of skirting. He's not saying anything that could get him in trouble, but he is, unless you read between the lines. Yeah. So he writes this, and he hints at the gendarmerie's legal functions on the islands that were at best ambiguous to the paper and the people. Now again, we notice how Jackson is situating the newspaper, the Herald, within the discourse of the people's press and voice, because it's important to see that Jackson is sort of positioning himself within this category of the people. Yes, so Jackson's agitation for and as part of a people culminated shortly after the first issue were out, so some 4 months later on, when his labor union organized a strike against the poor working conditions and lack of rights presented by the laborers on the islands. Now, the strike took place during 3 weeks in February 1916, and as the laborers returned to work with better working hours and a small raise, Jackson responded to a friend who had asked him why he had conducted such a hot campaign against the planters. And so his response is quite long, But it's important to read this, I think. So he says to his friend on the pages of the Herald, the conduct of the planets today is very near the same as it used to be in 1783 when they had laws, see the next column, and you see the two columns next to each other here, to support them in their barbarous and cruel treatment of the slaves. There can be no difficulty in arriving at the necessity for such a hot campaign, appealing having proved fruitless. And he goes on, a certain writer said a few days ago that a lash of abuse is sure to leave the mark behind. Yes, the lash, not alone of abuse, but from the whip of the slave owner, has left its mark behind, and the planter will bear it to their grave. Figuratively, then, for every red-hot iron pinch inflicted upon the bound slave, the planter shall be pinched back threefold. For every leg lost, both legs will go. For every burn in the forehead, there shall be a scalp taken. For every 100 stripes, there shall be 200. For one case of hanging, there shall be 2. For every one slave branded, there shall be 10 sons of slaveholders branded. Think of the things more horrible of the slave's pens than think of the origin of mulattoes, and you will get a clear idea of why the campaign had to be hot. So here he's quite explicit. He's no longer, you know, saying something in between the lines. He's very explicit. And next to this editorial, Jackson has produced the laws used for regulating the conduct of slaves. So all the regulations from there. And in my reading, what Jackson is producing through this text, presented alongside the 1783 colonial laws, is an argument for cultural citizenship, a political act. It's a political act when he writes this, of engagement. And it's not merely the act of performing civic rights and adhering to democratic institutions, but it is a political act that bends these institutions to face themselves, show their limits and their failures, and in this way they rupture the social historical pattern and call out a people. So he's using deliberation and freedom of expression to counter the hateful institution of slavery that also grew from this colonial path. Right? So he's taking something from the colonial rule, saying, I can use this freedom of expression, I can use journalism to show the problems with the society. And through that, he calls up a people. Right, so I want to turn to the more cosmopolitan part of this, the function of the Herald. So the Herald was not alone in its political socialist-leaning agitation at the time. It emerged within an international multiplicity of publications and counterpublics, politics and social progressiveness, such as a large variety of journals and papers addressing African-American and general female publics. Now, these growing outlets were the result of cheaper production costs in paper, changes in postage taxes, and the telegraph, and widespread literacy. So in the US, journalism was only just beginning to undergo a professionalization in terms of organization, training, and ideology. But the institutionalization of the press was less clear-cut than it is today. And in Denmark, the four major newspapers published carried essays as well as lyrical reports and short news. But the practice of interviews and the objectivity was not implemented. As a publication distinct from the local colonial politics at the time, the Herald took its place among many other politically charged publications that were likewise distinct from the mainstream in both Copenhagen and New York, although Socialdemokraten, I have to say, was fairly mainstream. And they were journals and papers that opined on women's rights and common people's rights to education and sexual liberty, the civil rights and the African Americans, the civil rights of the African Americans, women and servants, as well as arts and education. So Jackson engaged with these diverse publications and cosmopolitan people and places in at least two ways. So the first way, the Herald worked as an amplifier. For his socialist politics and union work, and helped to make the networks and courses that he worked for visible. And by reading the Herald and meeting at live talks on the island, the readers responded to the address made by Jackson through the Herald. But secondly, the networking quality of the Herald incorporated both New York's Bergen and Harlem Renaissance, as well as the political progressives of both Denmark and New York. In New York, this was represented by the work of people like Ida B. Wells, who wrote searing comments and reports on the racial inequalities of US segregation policies. And in Denmark, progressives argued for social change in sexual liberties through widespread education. So these Danish progressives also supported Jackson in his newspaper, although decolonization was only sporadically discussed. Now these outlets constituted a community of political solidarity that worked towards social reforms. And if the Herald then was cosmopolitan, bringing about a global community of solidarity, it's not because it was of its dissemination. It was sent to Denmark for archiving, and it was sent to Jackson's friends and working collaborators in New York. But it's not because of that, and it's not because it covered the world in its pages. It did. It did cover the First World War, for instance. But I want to argue that if the Herald was cosmopolitan, it was because it created a public, a people that connected and stretched beyond the shores of the islands and beyond the colonial borders and connected people through their shared experiences. So what is journalism's role in that? Well, journalism's ability to reach far beyond the borders of a nation state without the aid of physical transport was first achieved using the telegraph. We know today the online world, but the first time it was the telegraph. Sending and receiving news through this novel technology was paid for according to a number of words used in the report, and this resulted in shorter and to-the-point reports. And the telegraph, also the company, sold the news to a variety of outlets, which meant that they had to be politically neutral so that they did not leave out any potential buyers who subscribed to particularly a political view. Now, those two implications of the introduction of the telegraph to communication in general, and journalism in particular, have been used by scholars of journalism to argue that the wire helped create the well-known journalistic style of writing objective and neutral news. Now, someone like the scholar Carey, who's a scholar of communication, he argues that in terms of language, the telegraph demanded scientific language, a language of strict denotation. And this led to standardized language that would be understood in the same manner everywhere as an invisible way of spreading God's word and enabling equality and sameness to all people. This is Carey arguing this. He says, I'm quoting him again, the origins of objectivity may be sought, therefore, in the necessity of stretching language in space. The telegraph changed the forms of social relations mediated by language. Despite Jackson's enthusiasm and belief in press and journalism's ability, freedom of expression, already in light of 1915, this picture of the universalizing cosmopolitan technology may be contested. In the US, the technology of the telegraph was controlled by a white majority and favored commercially viable news, and therefore it homogenized the news flow. So printing had become cheaper, as I said earlier, and circulation widespread. And although there were a keen interest in portraying the social inequalities in society, both in the US and Denmark, the journalists who specialized in this beat, they were called the muckrakers, and they focused exclusively on white people, poor white people. So the short and to the point reports, they favored headlines rather than background news, or background, in-depth background journalism. And stereotypes were more easily digestible to American readers. So at the time, the report even instigated violence against minorities using very quick and to the point stereotypes under the guise of objectivity. Let's say someone who's unfolding this argument, Gonzalez and Torres in a fantastic book called News for All the People. So rather than the universal moral and cosmopolitan connectedness, then the telegraph and the neutral language and objectivity helped ignore minority communities' creativity and citizens' voices, like the Herald. Now, if the use of the concept of objectivity and the cosmopolitan argument for universal solidarity seems flawed, then it is not only because it's unattainable. We are always a part of our errors and our beliefs and judgments of fairness, right? Such as those of the muckrakers and the journalistic peers at the time. But it's also because objectivity can then be said to do the exact opposite of it connecting discrete world communities and enabling solidarity. Rather than the dominance of westernized standards, errors and beliefs seems implicit when considering the representation of journalism, history and theory, and this dominance effectively excludes a variety of voices and communities. So how then may journalism be theorized? Well, cosmopolitanism in journalism be theorized. But I want to suggest that rather than using the telegraph to connect the universalized and arguably white world of the colonizers with the Herald, Jackson created a space within which opposing differentiated voices could be heard, constituting the cosmopolitan colonial space of St. Croix. Now, in line with Jackson's transnational connections, he did this by selecting and publishing reading lists, including publications by W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington, disseminating articles about the work done by these early civil rights activists, and addressing cultural questions such as the importance of music. So, and a further example, I have some examples from the paper. So he's, for instance, having this article, Getting Together. It was printed from The Outlook, which is an African, or was an African-American journal published on the East Coast. And this article presents the socialist and revolutionary vision as a moral development and which class, in which class relations and mutual hate and destruction are things of the past. And similarly, the New York Evening Standard up here reprinted this article by Ellen Wheeler Wilcox, explains the necessity of believing in oneself. And this last in the bottom, Ralph J. Bow, I think his name is.
Bow, sorry.
Well, what he's writing, he's quite a prolific writer in The Herald. I'm sure you know, I have a feeling you know. So he's publishing this argument, the way he's arguing for compassion with the poor of St. Croix, citing the empathy of Booker T. Washington as well as Abraham Lincoln, and calling his insights a deep sense of human rights and keenly susceptible to the needs of people. So what's interesting to me here is that the piece connects the American community rather than the colonial administration, right? So this is all about the American communities. So while the praise for the Danish freedom was connected to the press and civil liberties, it seems that moral and religious issues of solidarity was found in the States and in the African-American communities. So there was a connection, a cultural connection there. It comes around, comes forward in the newspaper. Because of their proximity, their material proximity on the pages, these inputs were related to and defined through relations to the people of the Virgin Islands and the global discussions of racial struggles and politics in the US and Denmark. So in this way, the Herald functioned as a connection to other points of cultural, political cultures and struggles. Yeah? Republishing articles from The Outlook and The Pathfinder and The Crisis, the Herald connected intellectually and culturally to a progressive and burgeoning civil rights movement in New York and created a large community for the African Caribbean people of St. Croix in which to reflect on their own circumstances. So, my last point is, so what happens when the Herald became part of the US? Is there only the first 2 years when Jackson was writing that there were Danish colonies? So it would seem from what I've said before, I've said so far, that the colonial administration, despite its violent past and present political problematic relations, may have been perceived as a structure of liberal civic laws, civil rights, and social reforms to aspire to, at least continue to learn from or operate with. Whereas the US and the African American New Yorkers in particular provided an embodied anchor of political identification, a people, and a point of departure for dissent and agitation for social change. And although Jackson was never explicit about this in the Herald in the months leading up to the sale, he saw the possibility of becoming American. Possibilities in that change. So shortly after the end of the strike in 1916, the Danish government decided to sell the colonial possessions, and although there's so much to say about the Herald in the months passing between the strike and the decision to sell, I'll limit myself to just giving you one interesting example, because it would seem to Jackson that it was quite difficult to combine the two, the colonial and the American identities. So he's writing this the day before he's going to be celebrating the very first 4th of July as an American citizen-ish, depending on where we landed on the previous talk. So he writes this: today we see the glorious Star-Spangled Banner waving over us. We know that all the ties that bound us to a European government have been broken. The name Danish West Indies have been changed to Virgin Islands of the United States. But the atmosphere remains the same. The Americans are here. The spirit of Americanism is absent. And he continues, the pain is greater than before. The days seem longer and more dreary. Liberty is in sight. We beckon it. We try to reach it. But like some enchanted object, we cannot lay hold of it. It's sad, isn't it? Yeah, this changes something for him. So he wrote this editorial flanked by the reproduction of the Declaration of Independence, right? So like the editorial on the strike that I read from earlier, that presented the law for regulating the conduct of slaves, an editorial that situated the people and history and the common struggle, this editorial connects to a political past. But unlike the editorial about the strike, this is a past that Jackson yearns for to be his, but one which is out of his reach. Now, the editorial begins with an explanation from Jackson of the events leading up to authoring and signing this historical document, the Declaration of Independence, we the people. But Jackson is not part of this people, not yet. While the islands are now American, the atmosphere, the colonial ghost, remains the same. And this, I believe, and having read all the papers from 1915 to 25, it changes something in Jackson's writing and political work during the following 8 years, from being citizen-producing act, creating ruptures and claiming rights, to performing civic rights and adhering to a democratic institution in a more traditional, deliberate journalistic mode, to citizen journalism, citizen media, in order to have political thrust, needs to have this historical groundedness. It cannot be based on these universals, it seems to me. So I'm gonna leave us here and leave David Hamilton Jackson shrouded in this ghost of colonialism. You see here the Declaration of Independence, this last one I read from. And I think that it helps us reflect on who the people might be today and what role journalism or citizen media, like the Herald, what role that may play in that regard. So thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. That was highly interesting. Are there any questions? Or should I start with my question? No, there is one. Great.
Thank you very much for a very enlightening presentation. I was wondering, how long did Jackson stay in New York City, and who did he associate with in New York City to be able to be fired up by their political and civil philosophies?
I don't know necessarily that it came from New York. He had friends in Denmark.
The
sort of progressives in Denmark had similar ideas. He was a socialist to a large extent. So it was, and socialism was a global movement, wasn't it? I don't know. I haven't followed his life, you know, because I'm focused on what he wrote and what that did. So I don't know how long he's been in New York. I know that he went back and forth, and I know that he also went back and forth to Denmark a couple of times.
Because he got the printing press from the people in New York.
That's the story. Yes, that he came to Denmark, asked for his for the constitutional right of freedom of expression, right, to print this first independent paper, independent paper on the islands, and he went through New York getting a printing press. I think that he had ideas of what he wanted to use that right to print for before he came through New York, to be honest.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's Very interesting, and we certainly need to have people read that newspaper and tell us about it. And now concerning the political opinion of Jackson, it has been of interest for many years, and I think back to Peter Hoxha Jensen was one of them who worked with Jackson. There's a historian, Anna Herbst, who in her thesis talks about Jackson not necessarily being a socialist, but as you also mentioned, and not only being in connection with a social democrat, but also the Politiken. So the matter is, who are reading the Politiken? Well, those are the radical liberalists, and more than that, the Henry George people. Have you run into his Henry George ideas, which is something that Anna Herbst focuses very much on?
No, not necessarily. Could you elaborate on that?
Henry George is what in Danish ends up as being Retsforbundet. It doesn't ring a bell, I can see, but the main idea is they're not socialist, but they believe in public-owned land, but private capitalism. So it's an interesting combination. And Anna Herbst believes that that's pretty much where his main interest is while in Denmark in the summer of 15. Also of interest, and I don't remember how much Herbst writes about that, but from my own studies, that he is in contact with the church while he is here. He is in contact with the Blue Cross movement. How important do you think his contact with the church is?
Well, it's certainly not something that is reflected necessarily in his paper. It's reported that he's given a talk at the Temperance Foundation, and the entire speech is reproduced in the paper. But it's not something that I've found to be a... it seems to me that what he's writing about is very much the labor movement, it's very much the people, it's very much grounded in a wish for social reforms. He actually goes so far as to, when the talk of the sale comes up, and those months between, he doesn't want to say what he thinks about that. He doesn't want to say, let's sell or let's not. What he does say, he has different opinion pieces, and then he ends all these pieces with saying, give us social reforms or sell. All these people, also his other editorials, people were working on the paper, they all end their pieces, their articles on give us social reforms or sell. So it's that kind of interest in the people and the working people and the labor movement that is what I see in the paper, most of all. It's not necessarily religious, it's not necessarily ownership rights as such. It is, of course, but it's the right, the more general rights of a people who he thinks have been neglected and not heard through journalism, through the public sphere before. I think he's right.
Thank you for your very interesting talk. Something I have wondered about is, did David Havenson Jackson ever learn any Danish? Because I would imagine that someone in the legal profession needed to know the Danish laws in the Danish West Indies.
I believe he had his education in the States, actually. And it was after the islands were American that he got that degree. So he wouldn't have needed to know anything about the Danish laws at the time. But I don't know if he knew Danish. He must have known something. He came here quite a long time.
He could make himself understood, but he would not give a lecture.
Oh, that's you.
So when he spoke on Israel's Place, that was definitely in English.
That was English and then interpreted. Okay. But he could have a conversation on an informal.
I really didn't have a question. I just wanted to let the people know. I really enjoyed your presentation of going through the Herald, and we've heard about it for so many years, even during my schooling, and they would take bits of it, pieces of the Herald, to bring before the people. And as well in the schools, your teachers would give you tidbits of it. But to go in and to see all of it in this manner, it's quite exciting. Well, all of this today, I mean, just for today, it's exciting, but the possibility of going in and having access to even more is exciting. What I wanted to let you know is he is considered quite a hero at home, because November 1st is Bull and Bread Day. It is the day that we celebrate D. Hamilton Jackson Day. It used to be a day where many of us would present workshops to educators and students and children about D. Hamilton Jackson and the great legacy. The music and songs would be sung on that day as well, and some parades, particularly in St. Croix. So just letting you know, it's even gone further beyond because of the things that he did in exciting the people towards, you know, knowing of what you should have.
Thank you very much. To follow up on your comments, is there have been an assessment of the influence of his work and the paper, except what we just heard up, from you? But has been any, I mean, research on that? Thank you.
Well, it's interesting that you asked that question. When I first found interest in the Herald, that was something that I wanted to do. I wanted to find out what it actually did and what it meant to people. And then after a while, I was researching this, and I found this is not my story to tell. So I didn't, and I'm working on journalism and what that particular journalistic style may, in more general terms, help us do in our own communities. I don't know if anyone has done that particular research, but it would be really interesting to try to catch the people who are just, I mean, he died in 46, but he's, you know, there must be people who know him and have you know, family or whatever, and have that sort of unfolded in some way. And I'm still waiting for someone who has anyone written a book about him, just because I haven't, you know, you learn in school in St. Croix, but I, you know.
one scholar that we know about that has written a small book, I think, by him is Mario Moorhead.
Right.
He's a radio personality
right.
at home, he's on the radio every day. And he's written a small pamphlet on D. Hamilton Jackson.
I think that there's a lot to do and learn about the man and the community. Journalism is my little comment on that.
So I want to thank you for a very empirically rich paper and very nicely conceptualized paper too. I suppose my question has to do where to situate this fascinating man in a kind of intellectual transatlantic current, and it kind of builds on Dr. Nilsson's question. So I notice with interest that Bauer's citing Booker T. Washington as opposed to W.E.B. Du Bois. The crisis is offered as a parallel conversation. Yeah, the crisis is quite a radical, it's the, you know, the talking piece of the NAACP is edited by Du Bois. He chooses to call his newspaper The Herald, which is a fairly conservative statement, right? It's not the liberator of William Garrison, it's not the liberator of abolitionism, it's not the crisis. Is he navigating these waters of radicalism in the way that you started off with by saying he has to be careful what he's saying? But at some points he's not careful at all, he's very radical, right? And then at other points he's quoting Washington, who's very conservative on these issues. He's no Du Bois. I mean, Du Bois is a socialist at this point. Washington is not. So I'm quite confused about where to place him, or perhaps he's just extremely nimble, which perhaps is results as a product of the environment in which he's working.
Well, I think, well, if you look at the reading lists that were in all of the Heralds, there was sort of a reading list that people ought to read, and you have both W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington cited there. You know, they're books that you need to read, and you could then find them through this and that, and you could order them. So he sort of advanced that and wanted people to do that. So he's not in one direction only, I think. And I think that that also shows the people who are writing in the newspaper. It's not... it's not only about the labor movement, it's not only about youth or it's not only about, it's quite broad. What it has in common is that it speaks to a very particular people, a very particular public, and they know him quite obvious that they know him, and he speaks in at town halls, and I think one of the first versions of that, or issues of the Herald, he names the square, the common square, the Herald Square. I don't know if it's still called that.
Yes.
But so he basically just boom, this is the Herald Square. So he has a real strong influence on people, but he doesn't seem to, it's not that I, he doesn't seem to be going in one direction. He has a lot of stuff about Booker T. Washington when he dies, about his life and death. But then, yeah, as you say, he seems to be going several directions. I don't think that it's a particular school that he's following in the Herald. But it's interesting that you say that the Herald, why the Herald, it's very conservative, it's true. I think it was still a colony, it was still under colonial administration at the time, isn't it?
I take the liberty to give the mic to myself. So I was just wondering, I'm quite intrigued by the way he uses all these historical documents to write up against, that he uses this slave punishment law from 1783 in order to sort of debate current conditions, and then also how he uses the American Constitution or the Declaration of Freedom. And I was wondering if when he uses that, as it seems from the quotation you read aloud, that he's using it to discuss how the people of the Virgin Islands don't really have the same rights as ordinary Americans again. But I was wondering if there was any that whether he was also discussing the rights of African American people in that, because as we all know, you know, it was written during the time of slavery. So does he make any comments on that aspect of that, or is it more Virgin Islanders as opposed to Americans?
He does write about America, and also about big cases that come out and issues that come up in American newspapers as well. It's not quite as much as he writes about St. Croix, of course, and that people, but it's quite clear that he does, both through citing and reprinting from other American journals, but also by taking up these issues, that he sees a connection. But at the same time, he also has things in there. It's, and that is what's so interesting. He's not showing a simple image or a simple picture of African Caribbean people in St. Croix at that particular time. It's not like, you know, they were this or they were that or they were, it's quite complex. And I think that is what the Herald does so well, that you sort of get a glimpse into a documentation of a voice and some nuanced image or picture of Caribbean people at that time, and I think that we might have all these scholarly discussions about rights and Danish laws and Danish way of looking at this, but this is actually from the horse's mouth, so to speak. This is how he, not only how he saw his own situation and his peers' situation, but also how he tried to change it.